president is once again using disinformation in an attempt to discredit Joe Biden. Last night, he made several claims without evidence, including this one about who is operating the Biden campaign.
Who do you think is pulling Biden's strings? Is it former Obama officials?
People that you've never heard of. People that are in the dark shadows, people that...
Oh, what does that mean? That sounds like conspiracy theory, dark shadows.
No, people that you haven't heard of. They're people that are on the streets. They're people that are controlling the streets.
I mean, you got to shake your head there, Daniel Dale. You're great at fact-checking this. The president offered no evidence. Tell us your reaction to the dark shadow claims.
It's almost too stupid to fact check. I mean, when you have Fox's Laura Ingraham telling you it sounds like a conspiracy theory, it's probably a conspiracy theory. Joe Biden is his own man. His campaign is run by Democrats, many of them conventional Democrats for many decades. And there are no shadowy figures, you know, on the streets or in dark clothing pulling Joe Biden's strings. This is another dishonest attempt by Trump to try to foment fear about a candidate who's been in the public eye for many years.
It follows a pattern, right? Amanda Carpenter, who wrote a book on gaslighting, it talks about how it fits this kind of pattern of, I have this secret to reveal here. At some point in the future, I'm going to show you all the evidence of it. That never comes, and yet, you know, he propagates this kind of stuff. I mean, it's a pattern, is it not, with the president?
It's a long pattern. This president is a conspiracy theorist. You know, he essentially entered a Republican life promoting this racist conspiracy theory about Barack Obama's birthplace. He's promoted conspiracy theories about windmills supposedly causing cancer. He's repeatedly uttered conspiracy theories about millions of people voting illegally in California. He had a conspiracy theory about Ted Cruz's father being involved in an assassination. So he just does this, and he's doing it again.
Yeah, I mean, and as you remind people, there's some they might have forgotten, some that he's used against Republicans, too. The other way, and this is arguably even more dangerous, right, because he and his allies will use deceptive or even doctored video, which services such as Twitter have labeled as such. Are you seeing more of this?
Yeah, they've been doing this throughout the campaign, but we had four of them in a very short span, like 2 days on Sunday and Monday. We had the Trump campaign's so-called War Room account tweet a grossly misleading video in which they tried to make Joe Biden seem confused, saying, you won't be safe in Joe Biden's America. In fact, he was saying that while Trump and Pence argue, quote, you won't be safe in Joe Biden's America, that's ridiculous because Biden said the violence we're seeing right now is taking place in Trump's America. We had a White House aide, Dan Scavino, tweet a video in which they replaced the legendary entertainer Harry Belafonte falling asleep in a 2011 interview with Joe Biden, wrongly making it seem as if Biden fell asleep. We had the president himself tweet a video of a random 2019 New York City crime with the label Black Lives Matter / Antifa as if they were responsible. They aren't. And we had a senior Republican, Congressman Steve Scalise, add two words to a quote in an exchange Biden had with a progressive activist that the progressive activist never said. And it was even more egregious because this activist has the disease ALS and speaks with a computerized artificial voice. So they were adding in this artificial voice words that he didn't say in that exchange.
Listen, folks, it's disinformation, which by definition is deliberate. And many of these things are flat out lies. Daniel Dale, thank you for keeping tabs on them. We'll keep doing this as often as we can. Well, for more on other story we've been following today, social unrest unfolding in some American cities, what it means for the 2020 election. I'm joined now by the former mayor of Madison, Wisconsin, Paul Soglin. Mayor, thanks so much for taking the time this morning.
Good morning. Thanks.
So I want to ask you, you told Politico this week that looting and violence taking place in cities like Kenosha are playing into Trump's hands. In your view, when you saw the former vice president yesterday very, very definitively say, looting, violent protest, that's not okay. An important message to hear from the Democratic nominee?
I think it is. I think it's important for all of us, particularly the leaders of the protests. This is something we encountered, you know, 50 years ago, and it continues today, where you've got a very tiny group that uses the cover of a larger peaceful protest to do some property damage and lawless behavior. It's incumbent upon all of us to say, no, that is not acceptable. But that pales in comparison. And I'm not in any way excusing some of this activity in Kenosha or Portland or elsewhere, but it pales in comparison to the change that has taken place in this nation since Donald Trump has become president. It used to be that parents would take their teenage kids to the movie theater and drop them off, or take them to soccer practice. Now they're taking them with highly deadly automatic weapons across state lines to kill people.
Yeah,
this is Donald Trump's America.
Tell me the effect of hearing a sitting president defend that kind of vigilantism. I mean, he said it outright. You know, this is Kyle Rittenhouse, 17-year-old, charged now with homicide. The president defending this and welcoming it, it seems, in some cities as his supporters come in situations where police there do not want this and local leaders. What is the significance of a sitting president endorsing that kind of activity?
The culture of any organization, any government, any nation is set by the leader. And we here in the United States, in Donald Trump, have a leader who's created a terribly flawed culture in his failure to not only speak out against racism and pander to the perpetrators of hate, but when he condones white nationalists, when he condones hate groups, as he's done continually in his administration, he's giving license. He is sending a message. He is encouraging exactly what we saw in Kenosha with this 17-year-old conveyed across state lines by mom, kill people. And he is setting the tone. It's something we should not be surprised about. Donald Trump's entire career, private and public, domestic and international, is to create chaos, create conflict, and then step back and say, I'm the one who brought you peace and tranquility. He did it with North Korea. Right. He's doing it in the United States.
Let me ask you this, because, and you noticed this as well, the people in your state, voters, are distraught, certainly, about police officers murdering or using excessive force against African Americans, but also for the safety of their communities. Tell us what the politics are there now, to the extent you can kind of put your finger on the pulse. Are these protests driving people, some people, into the president's camp?
I'm fearful that they may. We got a president who came into office exploiting the politics of resentment. What he really did is he pandered to people saying, I am not going to make your lives better, but I'm going to make the people who you dislike, I'm going to make their lives worse. And he's changed that into the politics of punishment. And so now what's happening is we've got a group of folks in the middle, call them undecideds, call them fluid in terms of where they're going to pull the lever in November, but they are torn. They are torn between the continuous murder and barbarism that African Americans in particular are facing at the hands of law enforcement and the safety of their neighbor's business, the safety of their community shopping. And we've made great progress in this country in the last few years in waking up and understanding that there's an enormous step we have to take in terms of dealing with institutional racism. Those folks are coming along with us. They're now having some doubts. And I'm just fearful. And your last segment where you outlined all lies and betrayals we're seeing from Donald Trump, that they can be misled into believing that he will, in another 4 years, make this country better for them.